periodic axle fracture form an important part, and I don't think the adjustment axle force is discussed too much. So I will just take you through some concepts in periodic open axle fracture, and maybe you will benefit from it. The classification of periodic foot and ankle fractures, the gold standard, like the Lock Hansen, is the Dias Ajian classification which you use. And it is based basically on the structural pattern of the fracture. It gives you treatment options and it gives you the possible complications. These three things are covered under this classification. So it's very simple. If you go through this classification, there are basically four types and two special fractures. So there are six types of fractures in children around the ankle. Okay? They are all basically artificial injuries. The first type is known as the SI or the supination inversion injury. And clinically you can diagnose it because the foot and ankle will be in balance. Right? The second type is pronation inversion extend rotation or PWER, PWER. SI and PR. Now the PR is in valgus. If you see, one is in varus, one is in valgus. The third one is supination extend rotation. Here the distal fragment will be externally rotated. You can look at the foot and say what injury you have here. And the last one is in plantar flexion. So supination, plantar flexion. So four very simple types of ankle fractures which you can clinically pick up, and these are how they are classified. I'll go through each separately. Right? So this is also considered as the periodic part of the Lock Hansen classification. And two special adolescent fractures which we see. One is the TLU fracture and the second is the triadolescent fracture. We'll talk briefly about that in the end. So the supination inversion injury, if we go through that, there are two stages of the supination inversion injury. Right? The first stage is an adapting force on the fibula. Right? So you can have either a sprain or a strain, or an epiphyseal type 1 injury of the fibula at the lower end of the physis. And the second is when the talus shifts, it pushes off the median malleolus and actually crushes it. Right? So this is a devastating injury if the second stage is also happening, and most often than not we get a growth arrest because this is type 4 called a hazard with crushing. Right? So that is what happens. The overall deformity is varus angulation. Looking at the foot and ankle, you can say that this is a supination inversion injury. What are the clinical findings? On physical exam, you may just have simple local tenderness over the fibular fibre, a type 1 injury or a periosteal injury somewhat there. X-ray may be normal, or there could be a deep soft tissue swelling over the fibular fibre, which you should look for very carefully. And later on you might see some newborn formation which tells you that there was an injury to this region. Right? This is comparable to a periodic ankle sprain. Okay? Sprains usually don't happen in kids, but a type 1 or a part 1 of the supination inversion could be considered as a periodic ankle sprain. Treatment is usually give support and encourage early mobility with an air cast or a small splint, and the kid should be fine. Rehabilitation does play an important role. Now the last physis to fuse about the ankle is the distal fibula, right? So you can have a sprain or you can have, as I said, a type 1 or a injury to the distal tibial physis. It's very important to pick that up. The tibia is usually closed. The fibula is still open and the child gets a supination inversion injury. How does that affect you? Because in adolescent age group, if you get an isolated type 1 fracture, it is imperative that it is accurately reduced. Problems being, there is no remodeling happening at that age. Unless you get a mortise right, they end up with swelling. So this sort of an injury may look innocuous to you, but unless you get a stable and perfect article of congruity, confirmed by an arthrogram, you will end up with a swell. Right? So be aware that an isolated fibular fracture in an adolescent needs to be taken a little seriously. That is how it should be. Now this is a 15-year-old with an isolated fibular physis injury which was not treated adequately, and this is how it healed with displacement, and then what happens is that they get a spur and which becomes painful over a period of time and may need arthroscopy or some kind of a burning of that region so that the pain gets eliminated. So epiphyseal injury, fibular type 1 fault arthritis, look at it very critically if your child is 13, 14, 15, because it's not going to be modeled. You can't cast it and send it home. Right? And that needed surgical injury. What is significant about the stage 2? As I said, from the fibula, as the talus is pushing the median malleolus off, type 1 here, complete avulsion of fibular epiphysis, spicing and a crushing injury there. So this is either salt iron 3 or 4 medial nodules, more often 4. Remember that this is a crushing injury, and all these kids, the parents, the first thing you need to tell them is about bothering. Because you will have a problem when they come to you later on. And it's always healthy to do a CT scan in all these children. Because it tells you the amount of crushing and formulation, helps you counsel the parents much better. So what are the stages of treatment in this? Again, first thing you will do is get a satisfactory reduction. You could do it closed, you could do it open. But when you get a reduction, you must confirm that the articular contour is good. So you have two parts to it, the joint line and the epiphyseal line. Both have to be perfect. Second thing is that there has to be some stability. This seems okay, but this is how it slips in a car. And at 4 months post-injury, you can see that there is an incongruity. Right? There is an incongruity there, and that has led to a later problem. It's important that you will do a proper reduction and you will confirm the articular congruity as well as you will give good stability. Okay? So the ideal treatment should be getting the fascial width right, the articular congruity right, and a KYL is not a good idea. What you need is a transverse compression screw. So this is the complete treatment along with an arthrogram. So the quality of reduction after you do this has to be confirmed by an arthrography. So this is the complete treatment of this injury. Reduce the fibular spicing, type 1, salt iron is usually prothallusion, but accurate articular congruity on either side. You may pass a pin in the fibula, may not pass. But what is important is the tibial articular congruity and a fascial alignment and a compression screw and an arthrograph. All things followed by a supplementary cast. This is the complete treatment. And finally, please follow the fascial recovery, because you have to look at the salt iron lines, the Harris growth arrest lines. Every 6 months take an x-ray. If they are growing parallel to the joint line, probably there will be no bar. If there is a convergence on the articular side, there is an epiphyseal bar which is going to cause a growth arrest. So radiologically, you can monitor the Park Harris or the Harris growth arrest line. And these lines, at time of injury, when there is a growth cessation, when the growth resumes, these lines have to be parallel to your fascial line. If they are parallel, you are good. If they are converging, you are going to end up with a growth arrest. Right? So please look for symmetrical migration of the Harris Park growth arrest line. That is what is important in a long follow-up. And counsel. What about the fibula? If it falls back into place and arthrogram is good, may be left alone in the cast. You test it after tibial fixation. It is usually stable and doesn't need fixation. But this is the fracture which has the highest rate of complication. So please be aware of this fracture. And as I said, it's a crushing injury. The second type of injury versus the varus injury was the pronation eversion external rotation, which is the valgus injury. Now the peculiarities of this is that the fibular fracture is metafascial and it is extra articular. So look at the fibula, that gives you a clue also. An extra-articular metafascial fracture and intra-articular. So the pathology here is the tibia has got a salt iron type 1 or type 2 avulsion type of injury, and the fibula, there is a large periosteal flap attached to this fragment here, and the fibula is usually extra-articular and metafascial. Right? So the problem here is, you can see what happens here, there is a large periosteal flap and the tibial is posterior tendon and the neuromuscular structure. So they can get entrapped and prevent reduction. So these are the two problems which you must anticipate. What's unique about the fibular fracture? It's a diaphyseal fracture. It's a green stick fracture. The overall deformity is valgus angulation as compared to the varus earlier. Most of these can be treated by a close reduction. Right? If they are unstable, you can put a couple of metafascial screws so that your stability is restored. Fibula may be casted and left alone. This usually is all right. Salt iron is 2 and 1 don't give so much growth arrest. 3 and 4 higher growth arrest. 5 always. 6 is the worst. Right? So in ascending order, type 1, type 2 injuries give lesser growth arrest. Right? So trans metafascial screws here. Unstable fractures, to minimize the chance of growth arrest, if you want to put a pin through the fascia, there is no metafascial fragment, then put a smooth pin. So in case you need to cross the fascia, the earlier two screws you saw were metafascial. If you have to cross the Pisces scope, no compression across the epiphyseal line. And always make it center. So that if there is a growth arrest, it's usually symmetrical. So aim at the center of the joint or the epiphyseal plate when you are putting a fascial wire across the Pisces. And then you can stabilize it in tight poly injuries where you don't have a metaphyseal fragment. Something like this. Two smooth wires they are used for fixation. Variants of this can be problems. An avulsion of the medial malleolus is a variant of the PER injury. A small bit of bone there. Either you can put wires across, but like in an adult, normally you would use stainless steel wire. Here you don't put a stainless steel wire, you use an absorbable suture across the fascia. So the compression is not really very rigid and doesn't cause growth there. So smooth pins and a suture instead of a stainless steel wire mode, so that it doesn't cause problems. That is how you do it. And another option is a small screw. So if you have a very small screw which is available to you and can give you compression, maybe an intra-epiphyseal screw would do the trick. So that is the second thing. 12-year-old example of an injury. Okay. All the images have disappeared also. My computer is light up. No, I can't see it. The PowerPoint version, the macros they enable them. Inside of compound fracture. So pronation, eversion, extra rotation injury. And this was the best close reduction to answer your question. Now when you get a reduction like this, probably you expect remodeling, but that usually doesn't happen for two reasons. One, the partial is not accurate, and secondly, there may be interposition. So the next step, the complication for such a mal reduction is usually interposition. And interposition is a periosteal clasp. There's a huge periosteal clasp, and very often you might get the tibialis posterior stuck in that region. So you must get it out of the way. The neurovascular may also be trapped. It's important that you open it. So thus an open reduction becomes mandatory. And when you open reduce it, you will find that there's an interposed periosteum there which needs to be pulled out to get this flap here. And then once you remove the flap and suture it back, and then you will put smooth pins. Right? So that has to be extracted. And the metaphyseal part, again, the compression screw has to be metaphysis to metaphysis. Whereas the smooth pin is through the epiphyseal and put it in the center as far as possible. Fibula can be ignored. So the next injury after a valgus injury is the external rotation pattern. The supination external rotation pattern is actually a torque injury. Right? So the torsional injury here may be a spiral fracture of the metaphysis or a psoriasis type 1. And then after the tibia fails, the fibula fails. Versus the adults, where the fibula fails first and then the tibia fails in adults. Here the tibia fails first and the fibula fails next. So this is what happens. So psoriasis 1 or 2 distal tibial fracture, and the second stage is a fibular fracture. Right? So this is 1 and that is 2. Okay, sometimes on an x-ray you may just see a thin or faint fibular fracture, and you might miss the tibial fracture if it is a psoriasis 1. So critically evaluate the gap of the fibula. Okay, that is very important. So overall pattern is external rotation, and you will see that the leg is external. So look at this fracture, an isolated fibular metaphyseal fracture. Okay, you think that this is innocuous, but if you see the lateral view and the fascial width, it's open anteriorly as compared to posteriorly, and the gaps are not right. Okay, but don't rely only on the x-ray. Just look at the foot. The fibular fracture is obvious, the tibial fracture is not so obvious, right? So look at the fascial line, but just look at the foot. How is the foot line? It's simple. You examine the foot, you know that it's an external rotation injury. So the external rotation injury needs to be reduced just by internal rotation, and that is the key. Always examine clinically also, don't just look at the x-rays or send x-rays on WhatsApp, because that doesn't give the whole picture. And then the reduction requires a proper derotation maneuver. Okay, so beware of isolated fibular metaphyseal fractures where the rotation may be missed. And the complication of this is a malrotation, and malunion is malrotation. So important to look at the rotation, that's post reduction, comparison views. So look at the width of the physis on all the x-rays. Now the psoriasis type 1 injury becomes more apparent after you have done that reduction. Most of these are treated by reversing the mechanism. So just internally rotate the distal fragment, close that gap. Once you do that, you're alright. If this is stable, you can cast it. If it is not stable, again metaphyseal screws may be used. And complications, as I said, are translation. Sometimes there may be a posterior translation in addition to rotation, which has to be picked up, and you may need an anterior translation. So you have to pull it forward when you internally rotate. Okay? And that is how it should be done, so that the width is matching each other. Right? So pay attention to these small things when you are doing reduction. If it is unstable or swollen, you can use metaphyseal screws. Complications are rotational deformity due to incomplete correction. Fascial arrest is rare, as you saw it is psoriasis 1 and fibula is metaphyseal. The last pattern is supination plantar flexion. In supination plantar flexion, you will see that the foot and ankle is in equilibrium, and there is an anterior translation of the shaft. So the components are obviously an anterior bump which is indenting skin, and the foot and ankle which has gone posterior with severe equilibrium. Again, this is a psoriasis 1 or 2 fracture pattern, and treatment involves reduction by anterior translation. So flex the knee. What you need to do is, it's a posterior translation with equinus, you need to flex the knee and reduce it by reversing the deformity. So translocation has to be corrected, bring it forward, and you get an adequate reduction. Again, if it is unstable, put metaphyseal screws and give a cast. So small maneuvers are important. Complication is interposed issues like the PER fractures and inadequate reduction if the fibula is growth arrest is there. So the last two special fractures are the PU fracture and the triplane fracture. Right? These are also interesting fractures which you need to know about. The juvenile PU fracture essentially is an avulsion fracture of the inferior tibiofibular ligament. Now, the peculiarity of this is that this is an avulsion fracture, but it is intra-articular and intra-fascial, both. So again, this needs accurate reduction and you can't ignore it. And the second is the triplane, where the fracture line goes in three directions, through the epiphysis, to the plane, to the metaphysis. And you need to do a CT scan in all of these to get an accurate correction. Why do these fractures typically happen in this age group? For this, you must understand that the tibial distal physis fuses medially first. So when the child becomes mature, the medial malleolus and the medial half of the tibial physis is closed. But the lateral half towards the fibula is open. And then the fibula closes, as you saw in the first instance. So what happens is that if you get an injury at that age group, you have this part which is fused and this part which is open. So all the forces go into the unfused part and that gets pulled up, right? So that is the reason why you get a TO fracture or you get a triplane fracture. The pathology here is a fragment which is pulled off by the anterior tibiofibular ligament and that has to be put back. So you could do a percutaneous reduction here. The diagnostic pitfall of this fracture is missing it. Now you see this x-ray, half of you or most of you, if you see it at night, will dismiss it as a normal x-ray, right? But if you see very closely, there is a small flake which is overlapping here on the, yeah, you can see that towards the fibula. Okay, so you need to get a mortise view in all these ankle and injuries. So the fragment is best seen on a mortise view. You always get a three-plane x-ray. For an adolescent ankle, three planes, mortise view, AP and lateral. And most of these, once you pick this up, needs a CT scan for accuracy of reduction. Stabilize it with a percutaneous screw and an arthrogram if you want to do it close, something like this. Don't worry about epiphyseal closure because half the tibia is already closed. You need to get that accuracy of the joint line here and it is going to close down by itself in any case. So a 13-year-old who fell here, again you see this x-ray, you can see that there is a large TU fragment which is lying outside, but there is also a medial fragment. Right? So if you forget to fix this, you are going to be in trouble. And the CT scan shows that very well. You can see that towards the fibula, there is a big fragment in addition to the medial fragment. Right? So that has got avulsed, that is the TU fragment and there is a medial malleolar injury. So a CT will always define the TU fracture very well. And what you need to do is get that accurately into position, fix it with a cancerous screw, and that is how it was fixed and then it goes on to a satisfactory. Moving on to the triplane, first you need to know what are the three planes in the triplane. So you have a vertical fracture line, right, or a tangential fracture through the epiphysis. Then you have a horizontal fracture line which goes through the physis. And then there is a coronal vertical fracture which goes through the metaphysis. So the entire distal fragment has got actually fracture going into three planes. Vertical, horizontal and then coronal. Right? Since it is coronal, it has to be seen on a lateral x-ray. So when you see a triplane fracture or a TLU fracture, so now this might be mistaken for a TLU fracture. You think that only one fragment is involved. But if you look closely, the lateral x-ray will show you the vertical coronal split. Okay, so it's important to do a mortise view and a good lateral view and you can see that posterior translation there. Now this is a complex injury. Treatment protocol is you could do a close reduction and a cast, but you must look at alignment. Most of the times you'll end up doing open reduction and what is the approach and any other option. So close reduction and percutaneous fixation, I'll just show how it is done. And the information which I was harping about required to do this is a CT scan. From the plane x-ray, you can make out that there is a fracture line on the AP here. Right? The second fracture line is going horizontally, like I said, through the fascial plane. And the third is going vertically in the coronal plane into the posterior part of the metaphysis. Right? But if you do a CT scan, right? So the CT has to be done, the cuts have to be taken at two levels, one epiphyseal cut and one metaphyseal cut. And I'll tell you why that is important. So this epiphyseal cut show you the opening of the fracture which is there in the epiphysis and the plane of the fracture, right? So that when you are doing a percutaneous reduction, you will pass wires accordingly. So it demonstrates the two fragments and the direction of displacement. So what are they? They are in this radial plane. So what will you do? A metaphyseal imaging, and that shows you the fragment in the coronal plane. The same fracture. Below it is in the sagittal plane, above it is in the coronal plane, and through the physis it is horizontal. But they are all connected, right? Since they are connected, what can you do? You put pins into these two fragments, one pin here, and joystick them. So you will close this gap towards each other, right? When you close this gap in the epiphysis, so your wires are in the epiphysis, the metaphysis will close on its own because they are connected. Right? Did you get what I am saying? So once you close this, you understand that you pass that advance and this closes on its own. Right? So you don't need to put wires there. And after this closes, you need to pass screws in two directions. The metaphyseal screw will be anteroposterior and the epiphyseal screw will be transverse. So they have to be in two different planes. So this is the wire which is going to hold a cannulated screw there, and that is how it closes. So this is your fixation after fixation. So your joint line has to be accurate. Your arthrogram should show you that you have to have a transverse screw and you have to have anteroposterior screw. Transverse screw is intra-epiphyseal, AP screw is metaphyseal, and the physis closes on its own. Right? So this is the peculiarity of this fracture, that it moves in three planes, but they are connected to each other and are seen differently in different planes. And CT is important. Right? That is the final result. And you can use screws to fix them. Arthrogram to confirm the articular congruity. Example: 13-year-old boy with a similar injury. The CT scan defines it well. That is the fixation. So to summarize some pearls of wisdom, clinical deformity in ankle fractures gives you a good guide as to what injury you are dealing with. Is it in varus? Is it in valgus? Is it in external rotation? Is it in plantar flexion? Adolescent two injuries: tibial fracture and your trapezius fracture. These two fractures get a CT scan. You know more about them and accurately plan your reverse the forces for close reduction. Do arthrogram. Usually you will need to do arthrogram. If it is not coming accurate, look for interposition. You will get interposition. Compression screws are needed. K wires are not a good idea. If you pass K wires, they should be tensile, right? And always monitor for long term growth. And I'll run this video for a minute, if you don't mind. We have the International Fractures in Children Symposium in Conrad, which is co-hosted by Saraswati Foundation, Pune Orthopedic Society, Sensitivity Institute, and we will be conducting a 2.5-day session on all children's fractures, not only ankle.